It's been 2 whole years since I started my homemade replica building series that I like to call DIY Prop Culture Builds. Since then, I've built 24 props from some of my favorite movies, video games, and TV shows. The prop building process is one that I've always been obsessed with, the thought of taking something from someone's written word or imagination and drawing, modeling, or engineering that into something that actually exists is something I've been interested in since I was 5 years old. But as you probably know, I have only made replica props so far. I've never gone through the process of prop making myself, though I've really wanted to. I thought I'd save that for a special occasion, and the 2-year anniversary seemed appropriate. And what better source material to use than my favorite book? Well, actually, the sequel to my favorite book, The Lord of the Rings Trilogy. The Lord of the Rings movies are some of the most impressive adaptations ever. However, I personally think that this version is a bit far removed from how Tolkien envisioned his world himself. Peter Jackson and his giant crew may have got the broad strokes right, but any of J.R.R. Tolkien's fans know that, well, the devil's in the details, because detailed is what these books are. Some might say over-detailed. So using their book descriptions and nothing more, we're going to build 3 big swords from the series: Sting, Glamdring, and Anduril. Our work here is actually more straightforward than it probably seems. With the book series as over-detailed as The Lord of the Rings, he basically gives us an inch-for-inch description of each sword. Well, we'll start with the sword of Bilbo and Frodo Baggins, Sting. Now, before we get into the build, I should probably explain the inaccuracies, I guess, that I observe in the Peter Jackson version of Sting. Now, a good place to start would be, of course, with the book descriptions, and luckily for us, Tolkien is super over-descriptive about pretty much everything in his story. Unluckily for us, Sting, paradoxically being like the most famous weapon from The Lord of the Rings, doesn't have a super detailed description. In The Hobbit, it says, "And Bilbo took a knife in a leather sheath. It would have made only a tiny pocket knife for a troll, but it was as good as a short sword for a hobbit." And that's it. In The Lord of the Rings, in the first chapter, we get a slightly better description. "And fastened round his waist a worn leather belt. On it hung a short sword in a battered black leather scabbard." Now, since Tolkien describes Sting in a very ordinary, plain way, I imagine it's probably a very ordinary-looking sword or knife, really. This is supported by the fact that when Elrond read the runes on Gandalf and Thorin's swords in Rivendell, he knew what they were from, like, basically immediately. But when Bilbo brought him Sting, he didn't. Now, there's 2 specific things I take issue with on the blade of the movie. One, it's something called a wasted blade, which is where it bows out halfway towards the top. Although, taking the description of the book by itself, you could maybe infer that since it was elvish made, it might have some pretty little design like that. Tolkien describes other swords specifically with wasted or leaf-shaped blades, as he describes them, and Sting isn't one of them, so I can kind of safely rule out that Tolkien meant for it to be that shape. The other probably biggest thing that I take issue with is the fact that there are runes down Sting's blade, and Elrond specifically stated that there wasn't any when he read Bilbo's sword. The final point that I make before I start, something that you can actually see here, is that the blade glows blue in the movies when orcs are nearby. Very occasionally in the book it's described as glowing blue, but usually they don't describe its color at all. Usually it's just with a fire or of its own light or bright white. Usually it's described as probably looking white. So I generally imagine it that way, especially since there are differing depictions in the original source material. In a later chapter of The Lord of the Rings, Sting is described as only glowing at the edges. So if you want to go into specifics, you could do that, you could do blue, but I just imagine it glowing white. When redesigning Sting, I looked at the book descriptions and took the most repeated ideas. A well-polished blade, a sword that is shorter than a regular
sword, because it's supposed to be a dagger, and a plain black sheath. Since I decided to forgo the leaf-shaped idea, I did some research into the elves of Tolkien's world and figured out Tolkien largely based the elves off the ancient Celts, and their swords look like this. There are several swords in Tolkien lore, like the Barrow Blades and the Elvish swords, that are described as looking shiny and new because of some sort of spell on the scabbard or special metal that's used. I think Tolkien left that purposefully vague. I personally love the idea that it's the sheath and it has some sort of spell on it, so I had the idea of making the handle of Sting far more weathered to match the scabbard, and also to contrast more with the super well-polished blade.
Alright, there's a few materials you're going to need for this build. You're going to need some wood. I don't know what it is, some sheet wood type thing that was 24 inches long that is the perfect width and length for Sting. You're also going to need metal wire, tinfoil, aluminum tape, because, I mean, is it even a DIY props video without aluminum tape? Silver and black spray paint. Black leather or a leather substitute. This cost me $50. Modeling clay and some cardboard.
I used that wooden slat and drew out the shape of the blade and the tang, which is the long part under the blade that sticks into the handle and holds the sword together. Don't worry about the handle for now, as we're going to make that separately. I cut out the shape and whittled down the blade to the appropriate thickness. This was made really easy by how thin the wood was. To make the handle, I did it in parts. I modeled each section with clay for a few nights in a row, and then used the wire and foil to make a good structure for the clay to stick to.
So far I think Sting's coming out okay, but I'm not a fan of specifically the handle forms that I'm making. I think these, the bottom and top half, don't look quite right, so I'm going to scrape it off and then try something new.
Yeah, redoing the handle took way longer than I really wanted it to, but I'm glad I did, because with this more simplistic shape, the sword came out exactly as I wanted it to. When I came to painting, I took inspiration from the way my girlfriend told me she imagined Sting. She said after she saw the movie that, quote, "Sting was pretty accurate, but I thought the handle would be silver." As many Celtic swords have all metal handles, I took her imagining as I thought it was way more interesting than mine was. I painted with bronze, silver, and black paint to give the metal a tarnished look, as I was still going with that weathered idea. To build the sheath, I traced the dimensions of the blade onto a strip of cardboard. I left space at the edges so that Sting could fit into the sheath. Then I used the black leather to wrap the handle, being careful to get it as snug as possible. Thank you.
Now, when it comes to Glamdring, even though I haven't made that prop yet, I can just put a picture up here. It, in my opinion, gets the most things right compared to the other two that we're doing today. Now, its description in The Hobbit is, I think, the best description we ever get of it. And among them were several swords of various makes, shapes, and sizes. Two caught their eyes particularly because of their beautiful scabbards and jeweled hilts. Now, in a technicality, movie Glamdring passes. It has a beautiful scabbard, and it technically has a jeweled hilt. There's one jewel in there. It's tiny if you can spot it, but it's there. Now, even though I'm kind of praising this version more than the others, I do have two big issues with it. One, there's a fuller, or what people usually call a blood groove, running down the length of the of Glamdring's blade. People historically have the misconception that blood grooves, which this is why I hate that term, were made so that they so that swords wouldn't get stuck in enemies as they pulled them out, so that the blood would have a space to gush out, which is pretty gross. But that's not what they were meant for at all. It was actually a structurally sound way to shave off weight, since it's a metal rod that you're holding up, basically. It gets pretty heavy pretty quick, especially if it's wider. So if you want a wide or very dense sword, shaving off some of that inner material can really make it light. Now, the reason why I take issue with that is multiple times throughout the Lord of the Rings, elven-made swords are specifically described as being really light, which makes me believe that they wouldn't use fullers, because they don't need to take off that extra weight. Now, the final issue I have with this version is the placement of the runes. In the movie version, they're placed along the crossguard. When Elrond reads these swords for Thorin and company, he's specifically noted as unsheathing them, which, in my mind, would lead me to believe that the runes were on the blade itself.
Since Glamdring and Sting were both from Gondolin, I thought it appropriate to keep the Celtic design for now. I played around with the idea of adding the crest of the House of Gondolin in some way to this sword, since, in lore, it was originally made for the King of Gondolin. The description of it in the Silmarillion is a moon, a sun, and a heart, and although that's a little vague, I came up with some cool ideas that I thought would look good on a sword. The final product differs pretty greatly from this version that I came up with. In fact, all three of these swords do. However, the basics are still there.
Now, Sting, of course, was short, so we could get away with a piece of wood that small, but for Glamdring and Andril, we can't. So I went to Lowe's and picked up a 1x2x8 plank of wood for $3. Pretty good deal.
So I cut out a 40-inch blade and tang and sanded it down as thin as it could go. I created the base for Glamdring's crossguard the same way I did Sting's. I modeled the handle as I planned to give it a wood texture finish, separated by several gold rings. I also used a quarter-size imprint for the crest to go on later. I modeled the pommel to mirror the shape of the crossguard. Once it was all dry, it was time to paint. I went with gold, as in The Hobbit, when they find these swords, it said that Thorin was particularly attracted to them, and dwarves are noted to have a specific affinity for gold. Then I painted the wooden sections with a deep brown and then used some lighter shades to bring out the grain texture. I glued on the gems where they looked best and then included a red gem where each of the hearts on the crest were supposed to go. I used the aluminum tape to cover the blade. I used an online translator to get the proper Sindarin inscription for Glamdring, Sindarin being the ancient Elvish language. Yeah, he made the whole thing, the guy was crazy. And then I painted on the scriptures. I made the scabbard in a similar way to how I made Sting's sheath. I traced out the shape onto the cardboard, and then used wooden dowels cut to size so that the scabbard would be rigid. I wrapped the scabbard with a brown leather and then made metal parts out of the layered aluminum tape. Then I painted the aluminum tape. And Glamdring is complete.
Now, finally, Andaril is the sword that, at least out of the ones that we're doing today, gets, like, the best description in the book. The sword of Elendil was forged anew by elvish smiths. On it was traced a device of 7 stars set between the crescent moon and the rayed sun, and about them were written many runes. For Aragorn, son of Arathorn, was going to war upon the marches of Mordor. Very bright was that sword when it was made whole again. The light of the sun shone redly in it, and the light of the moon shone cold. And its edge was hard and keen, and Aragorn gave it a new name. He called it Andaril Flame of the West.
I had a very good idea of how I wanted Andaril to look, and I had 2 main visual inspirations. The first was King Arthur's sword, Excalibur, and Riptide from the Percy Jackson series. Yes, I know they're 2 completely different looking swords, but you'll see what I mean in a minute. I gave Andaril a straight crossguard to make it just strikingly different from Glamdring and Sting, since the sword was made by different people, originally by men instead of elves. I modeled the shield right above the crossguard, let it dry, and then modeled the handle and pommel. Once all that was dry, I used the hot glue to form the device of the sun, moon, and 7 stars. I painted the hilt with 2 coats. I started with bronze and then did some gold over it. The description, if you remember, stated, "shone with the light of the sun," which I imagined as a sort of rose gold. I used some strips of leather to wrap the handle. I built the scabbard the same way that I made Glamdring's, but I used a different shade and texture of leather, and painted the metal bits gold. In the book, Aragorn was gifted this sheath separately from the sword, in Lorien. It was said that the lineage of the sword was traced out onto the scabbard, so I used the same program that I got Glamdring's inscriptions from, and wrote out, Anduril, Flame of the West, Sword of Aragorn, King of Men, in Sindarin. After painting on the vines and flowers that were described in the book, Anduril and our three Lord of the Rings swords are complete. I am absolutely ecstatic about this. I've wanted to do a video like this for so long, and I'm really glad I finally did it. Each of these are basically exactly how I picture them in my head when I go and read the book. And going through the process of prop creation for a book adaptation on screen for the first time was a really cool thing for me. Thank you all so much for 2 years of prop culture builds, and of course all the other stuff that I get to do on this channel. Although I have a very small amount of subs as far as YouTube goes, that doesn't really matter to me, as the fact that you guys come back at all every week and enjoy these videos for all my efforts is the best feeling in the world. As always, that'll do. If you have a prop suggestion, then leave it in the comments below. They almost always make it into a video at some point down the line. In fact, I plan for my next build to be a fan suggestion, so look out for that. And of course, if you liked this video and wanted to see more like it, then subscribe and turn on the bell to get notified when I upload next.